Okay, welcome back, guys. Now, in this class, we are going to discuss about the coronary artery diseases. Okay, so good evening, everyone. Good evening. So now, in this class, we have to discuss about the coronary artery diseases, which includes the angina as well as the myocardial infarction. We have to see what exactly, what are the different types of angina, what exactly the myocardial infarction looks like, what are the clinical features, what are the changes that are seen in the labs, okay, what are the changes which are seen in the autopsies, that we will discuss today, okay. So having said that, now let's begin with the topic, coronary artery, okay, coronary artery diseases, okay, coronary artery diseases. Now in this coronary artery diseases, now I want to discuss the two main things, okay. One is angina and myocardial infarction, okay, myocardial infarctions. So now you can ask me, what exactly is angina? Okay, angina means chest pain. Angina, the word literally translates into chest pain. Okay, so there is pain in the chest. There is a pain, sir. There is a pain. Why there is a pain? I will tell you why there is a pain is because of decreased blood supply to the heart. The blood vessels, the coronary blood vessels are getting blocked because of atherosclerotic atheromatous plaque. Okay, see, generally let me tell you, imagine this is the one coronary artery, okay, this is the coronary artery, sir. Now this coronary artery is getting blocked by 10% blockage is there. Do you think there will be angina? Do you think there will be angina, chest pain is going to occur? Definitely not, sir. 20% blockage, no problem. 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, no problem, sir. Even 70% blockage in the coronary arteries, usually no symptoms. But above 70, when the coronary arteries are getting blocked by more than 70%, now the patient, whenever he tries, then also, when the person is trying to do some exercise, or when the person is trying to do some kind of activity, extra activity, strenuous activity, in that particular condition only, the patient is going to have the symptoms of the chest pain, angina is going to occur, okay? So, first let me write the different types of angina. Angina, sir, this chest pain, you know, it's because of the ischemia. Okay, angina is because of what? Ischemia, sir. What is ischemia? Ischemia is decreased blood flow. Why there is decreased blood flow? This decrease in blood flow because of atherosclerosis. So the atherosclerosis is decreasing the blood flow. The decrease in the blood flow is called as ischemia, and the ischemia is causing actually the chest pain. Okay, now how many types of angina are there? Stable angina, unstable angina, and variant angina, which is also called as Prinzmetal angina. Okay, stable angina, unstable angina, variant angina, which is also called as a Prinzmetal angina. There are three types of angina. Now you will get it out. Sir, what exactly is the difference between these three types? What exactly is stable angina, unstable angina, and Prinzmetal angina? See, now, dekho, stable angina means, yes, of course, there is a block in the coronary arteries. Okay, the coronary arteries, the arteries which are supplying the blood to the heart, the coronary arteries are getting blocked because of the atherosclerotic plaque. But usually, the patient is not having any chest pain. Sir. The patient is not having any chest pain. Okay? Which means, there is a block, but there are no symptoms, okay? When the symptoms are going to be there, when the chest pain is going to be there, the chest pain is going to be seen on exertion, okay? Stable angina, chest pain, seen on exertion or exercise. Whenever the person is trying to do the exercise, now heart requires more oxygen, heart requires more blood. But the blood vessel is blocked. Now this coronary blood supply will not be sufficient. When it is not sufficient, then this will cause the chest pain. Okay? Next. Stable angina. Okay, you understood. Chest pain during exercise. Okay, a question will something come like this. When the patient, a 50-year-old or 60-year-old, and the patient, he is trying to take the stairs. Okay, when the patient is climbing the stairs. Now, this is more activity, right? More physical activity. Now, the patient will start to have chest pain. Okay. Now, then what exactly is unstable angina? Guys, if you have any doubts, you can all the time put it in the chat box. Okay. Then what exactly is unstable angina? See, now chest pain is going to be there even with very little activity. Okay, the chest pain is going to be seen, sir, even with very little activity. Why? Because more blockage. Okay, more blockage, almost 90% blocked. Now the coronary arteries are getting 90% blocked. Now the chest pain is even seen on very little exertion, or we can say something like most of the books mentions that chest pain even during rest. Chest pain is not subsiding, chest pain is not going out. Okay, it's continuously there. Okay, so unstable angina, dekho. It is chest pain with little activity. Because more blockage, 90% blockage. Okay, 70% blockage, 90% blockage. Means more severe condition. Okay, so chest pain with very little activity, or even the chest pain is going to be seen on rest. Chest pain on rest, sir. Okay. Now, what is variant angina? The variant angina in this condition, there is no atherosclerotic plaque. There is no blockage. Okay, there is no blockage. Or even let me tell you what exactly is variant angina. Even before discussing about the variant angina, let me tell you what exactly happens in unstable angina. Unstable. Okay. What exactly is unstable, sir? In angina, the name is there, unstable angina. What is this unstable? Look here, unstable refers to, sir, the atheromatous plaque is unstable. Okay, whatever the atherosclerosis that happened in the blood vessel, whatever the blockage is happening in the blood vessel, so that plaque, that atherosclerotic plaque is an unstable plaque. It's a complicated plaque, which means this atherosclerotic plaque, it might undergo rupture. It will undergo rupture. So do you know what happens when the atherosclerotic plaque is ruptured? Now, platelets will start to come and adhere over there. Okay, adhesion will have platelet adhesion followed by aggregation, thrombus formation. Now, this thrombus will gradually completely block the blood vessel. So, leading to unstable angina. Even with very little amount of activity, there is chest pain. Okay, because the plaque is unstable. The atherosclerotic plaque is unstable. It is going to undergo rupture. When it is ruptured, more blockage of the blood vessels. When the blood vessels are getting more and more blocked, so even with very little activity, the chest pain, there will be chest pain to the patient. Okay, so that's unstable, sir. Who is unstable? Plaque. Okay, the atherosclerotic plaque is unstable. Okay, here you can very clearly see. Okay, the atherosclerotic plaque, it is ruptured. Rupture of the atherosclerotic plaque. Now, thrombus is going to form. Luckily, here there is not complete occlusion. But what actually happens is, the thrombus will grow, and it will completely block the blood vessel. Okay, there will be severe compromise in the patency of the blood vessels. Okay, now, next type of angina, which you want to know for your exam, is Prinz metal angina. So, what exactly is Prinz metal angina? Dekho, so this Prinz metal angina means there is no atherosclerotic plaque, right? No. Atherosclerotic plaque. There is no atherosclerotic plaque. Then what is the problem? There will be vasospasm, sir. Which means the blood vessels are simply getting contracted. The coronary arteries, they are undergoing spasm. Okay, they are undergoing spasm. When the coronary arteries are undergoing spasm, what happens? The blood supply to the heart is going to be decreased, causing chest pain. Simple. So, in Prinz metal angina, there is no atherosclerotic plaque, there is no thrombus formation, nothing like that. Simply, in certain individuals, the coronary arteries will undergo spasm. That is going to cause the symptoms. Okay, that's going to cause the symptoms, sir. So, that is all about the variant angina. Now, in your exams, they will ask you, if there is stable angina, what is the treatment that is given? Okay, let me write here. Treatment for stable angina. Okay, do you have any idea what is the treatment that is given for the stable angina? Imagine that I am the person. Okay, imagine yourself as a doctor. Now, I'm the person who is having stable angina. Sir, I'm saying that with work, I'm having more of chest pain. You know, what do you have to do? See, there is decrease in the blood supply to the heart. Okay, there is less blood supply going to the heart. Ideally speaking, you have to increase the blood supply to the heart. Okay, you have to increase the blood supply to the heart. But there is atherosclerotic plaque. Okay, there is atherosclerotic plaque. Already these blood vessels are already dilated. Sir, actually they are already dilated in nature. Okay. Now more heart activity is there. Now actually you need to increase more blood supply. But that's not going to happen. Okay, that easily. Yes, of course, there are certain drugs. But now what you have to do is, you have to decrease the load on the heart. You have to decrease the load on the heart, sir. Which load? Preload. Okay. See, there are drugs called as, one by one I will explain you. There are drugs called as nitrates. So these nitrates, what exactly are they? They are venodilators. Okay, this is the main mechanism of action. So these are the venodilators. Now, whenever I take a nitrate, isosorbide dinitrate, okay, sublingual nitrates, whenever you give me the sublingual nitrates, these nitrates are going to cause the vasodilation. Whenever there is vasodilation, what happens? So the venous return to the heart, okay, as a doctor, you should know all these things. Venous return to the heart decreases, means the venous blood which is coming to the heart decreases, sir. So what happened to the preload? This venous return is called as a preload. Okay, so the preload is going to decrease the load on the heart. If more blood is coming, heart have to do more work. If less blood is coming, the heart have to do less work. Okay, so if you give the venodilators, the veins are undergoing dilation, so the preload decreases, or the end-diastolic volume decreases, so there will be less blood coming to the heart. Less blood coming to the heart, sir. Okay, so heart have to do less work. If heart have to do less work, that's good. Okay, whatever the blood that is coming, that will be sufficient. Okay, whatever the blood that is coming to the heart via the coronary arteries, that will be sufficient. Okay, so the treatment for stable angina that will be asked in your exam is the sublingual nitrates. These are the venodilators. Now, the question which was asked in the exam is for the variant angina. Okay, for the variant angina or the Prinzmetal angina. So there is vasospasm. The blood vessels are undergoing spasm. How you have to treat this condition? Is you have to again make the blood vessels open again. So here the drugs which are used are calcium channel blockers. The treatment for this Prinzmetal angina calcium channel blockers. Okay, so the calcium channel blockers are going to be used. Usually beta blockers we don't use here. We do not use any beta blockers here. We will use the calcium channel blockers. Okay, that's an important question. For variant angina, it's the calcium channel blockers. For stable angina, we are going to usually see one thing. So, stable angina, look. Whenever the person is doing exertion, he is going to have chest pain. So, if you ask the person to stop working, okay, just you are giving the person rest. You are giving the rest, sir. So, with rest, what happened to the pain? One point which you should never forget is with rest, pain subsides. Okay, with rest, the pain is going to subside, sir. Pain will relieve automatically. So, you have to give him nitrates in the future. Okay, in the future, whenever he is having again the attack. Okay, he is having chest pain with exertion. He have to take the immediately sublingual nitroglycerin. Sublingual nitroglycerin, he have to take. Okay, so isosorbide dinitrate, you have to take, sir. Okay. But in unstable angina, what I have said you? More block, sir. More block. Once the pain comes, the pain is not going to subside. Okay, even with rest, the pain is not going to subside. Okay, in unstable angina, The medications do not usually cause any pain relief. One important point is, sir, if a patient is developing unstable angina, now the patient is having unstable angina, he is taking the sublingual nitroglycerin, but no pain relief. He will end up in, if you don't treat him, he will end up in what? He will end up in myocardial infarction. So, unstable angina risk factor, the risk of unstable angina is myocardial infarction. It's a myocardial infarction. Why? Because the atherosclerotic plaque, the complicated atherosclerotic plaque is now broken. More and more thrombosis is going to occur. The thrombus with time, it's going to gradually completely occlude the blood vessel, leading to myocardial infarction. Now, some students will have a doubt, sir, what exactly is myocardial infarction? Myocardial infarction, sir. We know about now you understood what is stable angina, unstable angina, and principal angina. Then what is myocardial infarction? See, dekho, in all these angina cases, there is no tissue necrosis. There is no necrosis within the heart. Okay, no myocyte necrosis. The heart is not dead. Now in myocardial infarction, so there is a necrosis of myocytes. Okay, the myocytes are undergoing necrosis. So now heart is dying. Not the entire heart, need not to be. That particular part of heart, for example, in the entire heart, maybe in the apical region, maybe in the lateral wall, anterior wall, posterior wall, that particular part, there is necrosis. So this is called as a myocardial infarction. Most of the students will think myocardial infarction means the entire heart is dead. No. Even after myocardial infarction, the patient can still be alive. Certain part of the heart is affected. Certain part of the heart is dead. Okay, that we'll classically call it as a heart attack. Okay, even with a heart attack, the patient is still alive. Heart attack means what? Some part of heart is dead. Okay, so these are the points which I want you to know, sir. Okay, basics. Now, let's study about the myocardial infarction. Important points about the myocardial infarction. Dekho. See, so myocardial infarction means what? It's a necrosis of the cardiac myocytes. Explained to you, it's a necrosis of the cardiac myocytes. The cardiac cells are dying. Now, what is the most common blood vessel that is involved? What is the most common blood vessel, sir? The coronary arteries, if they are totally blocked, there is a decreased blood supply to the heart. Ischemia is there, hypoxia is there. So, heart is going to die for sure. What is the most common blood vessel involved? It's a LAD, sir. Left anterior descending artery. Okay. See, left anterior descending artery. Here, if you look at the heart, sir, in this heart, this blood vessel, okay, this blood vessel, actually, which is shown in green color, that's the left anterior descending artery. It is anterior, right? This is the anterior side of the heart. The left anterior descending artery is the most common blood vessel that's going to cause the myocardial infarction. It's going to undergo blockage and it will cause myocardial infarction. So this artery is also called as LAD, is also called as a widowmaker artery. Okay. You know, you can understand it, right? If this artery is blocked, it's going to kill the males. Why? Because myocardial infarction is more seen in males, so that if a male is dead, automatically his wife is going to become a widow. Okay, that's the concept. So left anterior descending artery is the most common blood vessel that is involved. Now, which part of the heart is going to be affected most commonly in myocardial infarction? See, this left anterior descending artery, it is supplying the anterior wall. Okay, it's supplying the anterior wall, anterior two-third of the interventricular septum. Okay, but which part? Okay, first we'll go one by one. Let me put it in a sequence. Dekho. So this left anterior descending artery is there, na, sir. Okay. Where it is supplying exactly? What are the tributaries? Okay, where exactly, I shouldn't say tributaries, where exactly it is supplying? Okay. Apex of the heart, you know, this is the apex of the heart. Left anterior descending artery supplies apex and anterior two-thirds of the interventricular septum. Anterior two-thirds of the interventricular septum. Okay. Now, let me show you something like this. From top, I am showing you. Okay, I am showing the heart. I am just making a section like this, cross section like this. Okay, I am just cutting the heart, sir, at that area. Okay, now from top, I am showing you. See here, this is the right ventricle. This is the left ventricle. I am showing you from the top. Okay, now this is the anterior side. This is the posterior side. Now, this is the interventricular septum, right? So, to this interventricular septum, the anterior two-third of the interventricular septum is supplied by the left anterior descending artery. The posterior is supplied by the circumflex arteries, different thing. Now, this is an important point. Apex of the heart, anterior two-third of the interventricular septum, and anterior part of the left ventricle. Okay, anterior part of the left ventricle, all this anterior area. Okay, anterior part of the left ventricle. So, these are the three areas which are getting supplied by the left anterior descending artery. So, which blood vessel is going to be least commonly involved? Okay, anyway, it's written over here. The least common blood vessel that is involved in the left circumflex artery. Okay, left circumflex artery. Now, the left circumflex artery is going to be just like this. Okay, it is going to take a turn on the left side. It will go back, sir. So, left circumflex artery is going to be least commonly involved. This left circumflex artery, in one of the exam it was asked, left circumflex artery, it supplies which part of the heart? You know, anterior descending artery, sir, supplies apex of the heart, anterior two-third of the interventricular septum, as well as the anterior wall of the left ventricle. But this left circumflex artery is going to supply which areas of the heart? It's the lateral wall of the left ventricle. Lateral side, sir. Lateral side of the left ventricle. Okay. Lateral wall of the left ventricle except apex. Why except apex? Because apex is supplied by left anterior descending artery. Left anterior descending artery, sir. Okay, so from this slide, the only point which I want you to know is the widowmaker artery, that is the left anterior descending artery, which is going to be most commonly getting blocked, leading to myocardial infarction. The question that will come in your exam is, sir, if there is blockage of left anterior descending artery, it will cause myocardial infarction. Which myocardial infarction? Anterior wall myocardial infarction. Anterior wall MI, sir. Anterior wall MI. Okay, left anterior wall MI. Okay. And myocardial infarction will occur in the apex. Apex, true. And the lateral, in the anterior two-third of the interventricular septum. Now, after this, I have to teach you how many types of myocardial infarction. There are three types of angina are there. Stable angina, unstable angina, principal angina, the major types. Now, myocardial infarction is two types. Okay, the myocardial infarction is of two types. What are they? MI. It is of two types. Guys, do you have any idea? What are the two types of MI? Guys, do you have any idea what are the two types of MI? Yeah, fun mode, yes, of course. Yeah, we'll definitely do the physiology also, but after the patho, we'll start the physiology also. Okay. Yes, of course. Yeah, fun mode, you are adding a point. Yes, myocardial infarction, necrosis is there. Which type of necrosis? Coagulative. Okay, coagulative necrosis. True. No doubt, coagulative necrosis. Now, how many types of MI are there, sir? There are two types of MI. ST, elevated. Okay, ST elevation, MI, which is called as a STEMI. And non-ST elevated MI. Okay, non-STEMI. Okay, STEMI and non-STEMI, sir. See, STEMI means ST. What is this ST, sir? ST segment elevation in ECG. ST segment elevation in the ECG, sir. Okay, so STEMI and non-STEMI. Non-ST segment elevated MI. Now, how to differentiate between these two? Like, you know, what exactly is this ST elevated MI, sir? Non-ST elevated MI. See, now, let me put it in as simple as possible. In a simple way. So, this is your left ventricle, right? Left ventricle, okay. Now, left ventricle is made up of how many layers? Endocardium, myocardium, as well as the pericardium. Okay, endo, myo, and pericardium, sir. True. Now, dekho. See, this region, sir. Now, only this part of the myocardium is getting affected. Okay. So, that this area is called as subendocardial region. This area is called as a subendocardial region. Now, before going further, I want you to write one point. Okay, most susceptible region. Most susceptible region for myocardial infarction. What is the most susceptible region for the myocardial infarction? Is it endocardium? Is it myocardium? Or is it pericardium? It is subendocardial region. Okay, normally you know this is the endocardial region. So, this is the endocardium. Now, below the endocardium, there is a region. Okay, let me show you here. So, this is endocardium. Now, this is the endocardium. Okay, the innermost layer of the heart. See, endocardium is not having any problems, right? Because endocardium can directly get the oxygen. Okay, endocardium can have direct contact with the blood. So, it will directly get the oxygen from the heart chambers. No problem. But there is a region called as a subendocardial region below the endocardium, subendocardial region. So this subendocardial region is highly prone to ischemia. Why? Because in the heart, when the heart is contracting, in the subendocardial region, super high pressures are going to be seen. Very high pressures are going to be seen. So as there is very high pressure, less blood will come to that area. Blood will go from high pressure to low pressures. Okay. So, when the heart is contracting in this area, there will be very high pressure. The blood vessels are going to be totally closed, totally collapsed. So, that area of the heart is highly likely to develop the myocardial infarction. Just one point. Okay. So, now, imagine I'm the person who is having necrosis of this part of the heart muscle. Not the entire heart muscle is affected. Not the entire wall. Okay, just the subendocardial region is undergoing infarction. Okay, subendocardial infarction, sir. So, then I will be having, okay, look here, in NSTMI, okay, non-ST segment elevated MI, there is only subendocardial. Okay, ischemia and infarction. Only that part of the heart is dead, sir. Okay, that part of the heart is dead. But, see, there is transmural. If there is a transmural infarction, okay, see, the entire heart, the entire, not just the subendocardial, the entire this heart, this entire part, I shouldn't say entire heart, that part of the myocardium, okay, is totally now developed ischemia followed by infarction. So then you are going to have what? Then you are going to have ST segment elevation. They go here. Here the ST segment is not elevated, normal. The ST segment is not normal. So this is the ST segment, right? It's normal. But look here, the ST segment is elevated. There is ST segment elevation. Okay. So in STEMI, there is a transmural. Okay, ischemia. So, which region is getting affected? The entire transmural, if there is a transmural ischemia, then there will be ST segment elevation. If there is only subendocardial ischemia and infarction, there will be non-ST segment elevation. So, from now, you should understand, sir, in myocardial infarction, okay, in myocardial infarction, not always ST segment is going to be elevated, not. If there is a non-ST segmented in non-STEMI, the ST segment is not elevated. Of course, myocardial infarction happened. Sir, myocardial infarction happened, sir. But still, right here, ST segment is not elevated. Okay, ST segment is not elevated. In transmural ischemia, ST segment is elevated. See, that's why the name writes STEMI and non-STEMI. Okay. So, the two types of myocardial infarction are completed here. Okay, the two types of myocardial infarction, sir. Now, let me talk about the cardiac markers. First, let me talk about the cardiac markers. Now, imagine I'm the person. Okay, I'm the person who is having a myocardial infarction right now. I'm the person who is having the myocardial infarction right now. I'm coming to your clinic that I'm having severe chest pain. I almost became unconscious. I'm not in my conscious, sir. So, my relatives brought me to your hospital. Now, they said, like, this is a patient of diabetic, like, you know, he's a previous known case of atherosclerosis. Like, you know, blockage of the blood vessels, coronary arteries blockage is there. Now you have suspected, okay, this patient might have gone into myocardial infarction. Okay, now what is, like, you know, investigation that you are going to do? So, normally students will think ECG. Okay, ECG. So, why? Because whenever there is a myocardial infarction, the ECG is going to show the ST segment elevation. But if there is a non-ST segment elevated MI, if there is a non-STEMI, ST segment is not going to be elevated. ST segment is not going to be elevated, sir. Other important points which I want you to know is, they go, in stable angina, there is ST segment depression. Okay, there is ST segment depression. But, see, in prinzmetal angina, there will be ST segment elevation. So, ST segment elevation is going to be seen. ST segment elevation is going to be seen even in angina, sir. In yesterday's class, I have discussed about the pericarditis. Okay? Pericarditis. Even in the condition of pericarditis, the ST segment is going to be elevated. Okay, not just this, there are so many conditions in which the ST segment is going to be elevated. So, ST segment elevation is not something specific, it's not something specific to myocardial infarction. So, if you want to know whether I'm having myocardial infarction or not, then you have to check for the cardiac biomarkers. Okay, you have to check for the cardiac biomarkers. Okay, what are the cardiac biomarkers? See, now, there is a necrosis of the heart. Okay, the heart is dying. The heart muscles are dying. When the heart muscles are dying, necrosis, pathological. In the beginning of the cell injury, I have explained to you. Sir, necrosis, there will be damage to the cell membranes. Cell membranes are going to be damaged. When the cell membranes are damaged, the cellular contents are going to leak. Okay, so the cellular contents are going to leak into the blood. So here also, The cardiac biomarkers are nothing but the cellular enzymes are going to leak into the blood. What is the earliest to rise in the blood? What is the earliest to rise? So this is the question that will come in your exam. What is the earliest to rise, sir? Any idea? Earliest to rise is myoglobin. Okay, earliest to rise is myoglobin. Okay, it's going to rise in 2 hours. It will come back to normal in 24 hours. Okay, myoglobin. Okay, so when my heart is dead, not the entire heart, that particular part of the myocardium, when it is dead, necrosis, that contents are going, the cellular contents are going to leak into the blood. The first cardiac biomarker to raise is myoglobin. Okay, myoglobin, but this is not specific. Why? Because myoglobin is also seen in the muscles. Okay, next, CKMB. Other cardiac markers include CKMB. Okay, CKMB. So the CKMB is going to raise in 2 to 4 hours. It will also come back to normal. Sorry, it will come back to normal in 2 to 3 days. It will come back to normal in 2 to 3 days. 2 to 3 days. Next, troponin I. Let me show it with a special color. Troponin I. Troponin I. Why I am showing it special color, the red color? Why? Because, sir, troponin I is the most important. Okay, as of today, it's the most important cardiac marker. Cardiac marker. Most important, most specific. Okay, most specific and most sensitive. If they use any of these words, most sensitive cardiac biomarker, most specific cardiac biomarker, most important cardiac biomarker, all are troponin I. Okay, all are troponin I. And this troponin I is also used as a marker of, it's also used as marker of reinfarction. Okay, marker of reinfarction, sir. So this troponin I is also going to raise within 2 to 4 hours in the blood, and it will come back to normal in almost 7 to 12 days. It will come back to normal levels in 7 to 12 days. Very important MCQ. Sir, what is the marker of, what is the marker of reinfarction? Previously, the marker of reinfarction is the CKMB. Okay, now the marker of reinfarction, the best marker for the reinfarction is the troponin I levels. Okay, troponin I levels, sir. Okay. Now, what exactly is this reinfarction? Some students will have a doubt, sir. What is this reinfarction? We couldn't understand. Not, okay, of course, yeah, myoglobin is raising and CKMB levels are raising. Troponin I levels are going to raise in the blood. Why? Because the heart is dying. Their levels, these are all the contents which are present in the heart. These contents are going to leak into the blood. So their levels will raise. Okay. But what is this reinfarction? There is a possible, right now I am having heart attack. There is a chance that after one day, or I am in the hospital, I am admitted in the hospital, there is a chance that I will develop the reinfarction. I will develop the reinfarction, sir. So how can you know whether there is reinfarction or not? Okay. See, now you are going to do, continuously you are going to do something called as a serial monitoring. Okay. Serial monitoring. Okay, why? Because, dekho, sir, this troponin I levels are going to stay elevated for almost 10 to 12 days. For almost 10 to 12 days, they are elevated, sir. After 12 days, it will start to come down. Okay, it will come back to normal levels. But my question to you is, sir, for 10 days, it is highly elevated, no? So, how it is used as a marker of reinfarction? It's elevated. How we can know that there is reinfarction? See, we are doing serial monitoring of troponin I levels. Troponin I levels. Serial monitoring of troponin I levels. When compared to the previous value, if there is more than 20% increase, okay, in the morning you have done my tropi levels. Okay, I am the patient who is admitted with myocardial infarction. Now, my tropi levels are, for example, of certain value. After some time, you have done serial monitoring of the tropi levels. After some time, you have just done the same tropi levels. Now, there is increase in the tropi levels. The tropi levels are increased by more than 20%. Then you should think that, okay, this patient have developed the reinfarction. So, serial monitoring of troponin I levels are done. There is more than 20% increase. It suggests reinfarction. okay, such as the reinfarction, sir. Okay, and okay, what we have completed, myoglobin completed, CKMB completed, troponin I completed, last two rays is LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, LDH, sir. So last two rays is LDH, it's also going to raise 2 to 4 hours, and it's going to 2 to 4 hours, it raises in 2 to 4 hours. Okay, it raises in 2 to 4 hours, come back to normal in 10 days. Okay, it's going to stay in the blood for almost 10 days, sir, elevated. So which LDH? LDH type 1 especially. Type 1 LDH. Important about this LDH, I will explain you later. Okay, importance about the LDH, I will explain you later, sir. LDH type 1 is going to be elevated. It's the last marker to raise. When compared to the others. Okay, when compared to the others, it's going to be last marker to raise. But if you look at the, say, 2 to 4 hours, some students will have it out. 2 to 4 hours, 2 to 4 hours. Okay, 2 to 4 hours. Sir, all are raising at the same time. No, yes, of course, all are raising at the same time. But last two rays is LDH. Okay, that's it. Yeah, LDH flip, I will explain you. Okay, I will explain you. Now, these are the markers. Let me write some other markers. Other markers, which we won't use them. Okay, previously we used to use these other markers, like ischemia modified albumin. Okay, ischemia modified albumin, heart fatty acid binding proteins. Okay. Okay, heart fatty acid binding proteins. These are also the cardiac markers which were used earlier. Okay, ischemia modified albumin, heart fatty acid binding proteins. These are also the cardiac markers which are going to be elevated during myocardial infarction. Okay, so just tell me, what is the first to raise? Myoglobin is going to be first to raise. What is the most specific, most sensitive, most important cardiac biomarker? Troponin I levels. What is the marker of reinfarction? Troponin I levels. Serial monitoring of troponin I is done. If there is elevation of this troponin I more than 20%, it indicates what? It indicates reinfarction. It suggests reinfarction. Last two rays is lactate dehydrogenase. Which type of lactate dehydrogenase? Type 1 lactate dehydrogenase. What are the other cardiac markers? Ischemia modified albumin, as well as heart fatty acid binding protein. Heart fatty acid binding protein, sir. Now, let me tell you about the LDH here itself. LDH flipping. One more, you are talking about the LDH flipping, right? So what exactly is LDH flipping? Normally, in one minute, we can say, normal person right now in my blood, if you check LDH levels, the LDH type 2 is more, LDH type 2 is more than LDH type 1 in my blood. Okay, see, why? Because LDH type 1 is primarily present in the heart. Okay, it's primarily present in the heart, sir. LDH type 1. But whenever there is a myocardial infarction, what happens is LDH type 1 is going to leak into the blood. So now in MI patient, what happens? LDH 1 will be more than LDH 2. So there is reversal. Normally, LDH 2 should be greater than LDH 1. This is normal. Let me write normal. Normal person. Okay, but in MI patients, LDH 1 will be greater than LDH 2. Simple. Okay, simple like that. So this is called as a flipping of the LDH ratios. Okay, flipping of the LDH ratios. Now, after this, let's talk about the gross findings in the autopsy. Okay, now, if the patient is dead, myocardial infarction, the patient is dead, sir. Okay, patient, imagine, unfortunately, the patient is dead. Now, look here. Let me write autopsy, gross findings. What are the gross findings that are seen on the autopsy? Now you have removed the heart. Okay, you have removed the heart. Now, actually, within the first 12 hours, okay, the patient is dead. The patient is dead and you are doing the autopsy. In the first 12 hours, nothing is visible, sir. First 12 hours, there is no gross morphological change, no change. You cannot find any change. It's just like a normal regular heart. There is no change. But if you want to identify Which area of the heart is dead? Which area of the heart have undergone myocardial infarction, coagulative necrosis? If you want to know, okay, then you have to apply a dye, sir. You have to apply a dye, which is called as a triphenyl tetrazolium chloride assay. Okay, triphenyl tetrazolium chloride. Yes, TTC. Yes, yes, one more, you are true. Triphenyl tetrazolium chloride assay. Okay, see, this test is done, sir. Okay, now you are going to take the heart, you are going to make into slices. Now you are going to apply this triphenyl tetrazolium. You are going to dip it into that this dye, sir, triphenyl tetrazolium chloride assay. Now, see, normal heart area, okay, normal heart area is going to take up the stain, red color stain. So normal area is going to take this stain, sir. Normal area will appear red in color. Okay, it's going to take red color stain. Now, infarcted area is going to be pale in color. Okay, now you can very clearly see here also. So, this area is not coming in red color. Okay, this area is not taking the red color, which means this part of the heart have undergone myocardial infarction. So, it's not taking up the stain. Actually, the concept here is, dekho, here why it is red? You can ask me, sir, why the heart is red in color? Because, see, this triphenyl tetrazolium chloride, okay, triphenyl tetrazolium chloride is going to react with what? It's going to react with the LDH1. That's what gives the red color. Okay, that's what gives the red color. Now, in this area, in the area of the myocardial infarction, there is no LDH1. LDH1 is leaked into the blood. Now LDH1 is leaked into the blood. So there red color cannot occur. So tell me, what is the dye used to identify the area of myocardial infarction? It is triphenyl tetrazolium chloride. Okay. So done. After this, let's talk about the gross findings. The gross findings already I have discussed. The patient, for example, if he is dead, now you have taken the heart. Now, in the first 12 hours, right, in the first 12 hours, will there be any changes? No gross findings. Okay, you can't identify anything in the heart, sir. Grossly, with naked eye, you cannot find anything. 12 to 24 hours. Okay, in 12 to 24 hours, what you can see is occasional dark mottling. I will show you the images also. Okay, dark mottling, sir. There will be occasional dark mottling. Okay, occasional dark mottling. Okay, spots, dark spots are going to be seen. Next, one day completed, 1 to 3 days. In 1 to 3 days, what can be seen with the naked eye is same dark mottling is going to be seen. See, in first 12 to 24 hours, this dark mottling can be present or absent. It can be present or absent. There is not a guarantee, like it every time it's going to be there. No such guarantee. Usually dark mottling is going to be occur from 12 to 24 hours. And MCQ point which I want you to know is, sir, dark mottling is the first visible morphological change that is seen with naked eye. Okay. So this is the first visible sign. Okay, first visible sign. Okay, our first visible sign on gross findings is a dark mottling. So 1 to 3 days dark mottling is going to be seen with yellow tan. Yellow color tanning. I will show all these images. Yellow color tanning, sir. Now from 3 to 7 days. So in 3 to 7 days, what you can see is same. Dark mottling is going to be seen, yellow tanning is going to be seen. Okay, dark mottling, yellow tanning is going to be seen with hyperemic borders. Okay, hyperemic borders, sir. Okay, so that area of the necrosis is going to have a hyperemia, more and more hyperemic borders, more reddish in color. Now you'll get it out. Sir, how hyperemic borders are happening? Sir, it's already 7 days, right? The patient is dead. By this time, the heart have undergone, decomposition have started, right? No. Now what I'm trying to put into your mind is, say, dekho, Now, myocardial infarction occurred, but luckily the patient survived. Luckily the patient survived, sir. Okay, luckily patient survived. So, after 3 days, in 3 to 7 days, now there will be hyperemic borders that are going to occur. Okay, the patient survived. So, then in 3 to 7 days, yeah, dark mottling, yellow tanning, and with the hyperemic borders are going to be seen. Luckily, the patient survived. In 2 months, that area of the infarction have completed that, totally now repaired. Okay, scar formation. Okay, complete scar formation. Okay, complete scar formation. So, tell me, scar formation is going to be complete by 2 months. Within 2 months, you can see the complete scar formation in that area, totally fibrotic area. Okay, so 3 to 7 days, dark mottling, yellow tan with the hyperemic borders. 1 to 3 days, there will be dark mottling with yellow tan. Okay, in first 12 hours, no grass findings. In the 12 to 24 hours, you are going to see the dark mottling. Okay, done, sir. Next, grass findings completed with eyes. These are the changes that you can see with light microscopy. Okay, with light microscopy, let me write. With light microscopy, what you can appreciate? See, microscopic findings within the first 30 minutes. The first 30 minutes after the myocardial infarction occurred. Tissue dead, sir. Tissue dead. Now, what you can see in the first 30 minutes? There is no change. No change you can appreciate in the infarcted area. Next, 30 minutes to 4 hours. The first 4 hours, you can say. Okay, 30 minutes to 4 hours. What you can say is, the heart muscles, the muscles which are normally very much parallel, they are like in the parallel rows, which are very beautiful. Okay, in yesterday's class also I have shown you the normal histology of the heart. Now the heart muscles are going to show the wavy pattern. Okay, wavy fibers are going to be seen. Wavy fibers. I will show the images. Wavy fibers are going to be seen in the first 4 hours, 30 minutes to 4 hours. Now after this, the next most important is 12 hours to 24 hours. In the first day, 12 to 24 hours. 12 to 24 hours. 12 to 24 hours. So, what is going to be seen, sir? 12 to 24 hours. In 12 to 24 hours, wavy fibers are seen. Okay, no doubt. Okay, wavy fibers are seen. But early neutrophilic infiltrates. Okay, the patient luckily survived. Now, inflammation will start right in the area of necrosis. We know necrosis is always pathological. So, wherever there is necrosis, there will be inflammation. So, wavy fibers are seen. Along with that, early neutrophilic infiltrate. Okay, early neutrophilic infiltrates are going to be seen. Okay, early neutrophilic infiltrates are going to be seen. Okay, along with that, okay, there will be contraction band necrosis. Okay, there will be contraction band necrosis. See, what is this contraction band necrosis? I will explain you. When you do reperfusion, okay, sir, these dead myocytes, when you do reperfusion, more amount of calcium is going to go into that area. Because of the calcium, the myocytes will contract, and they are stayed in contraction stage itself. Okay, so this is called as contraction band necrosis. I will show you the image. Image based questions are important. Contraction band necrosis. Okay, I used to remember it something like after the death of the person. Okay, once a patient is dead, he is going to have rigor mortis, right? He is going to have contraction. Yes, even same like that. After the death of the heart, okay, the myocardial infarction, sir. Okay, myocardium is dead. But after that part of the muscle will undergo contraction. That is called as a contraction band necrosis because of the reperfusion. More calcium will go and that will cause the contraction band necrosis. Next, 1 to 3 days. In 1 to 3 days, in the first 1 to 3 days, sir, what you will be seeing under the light microscopy? It's a more inflammation. Now, more inflammation started to happen. That is a dense neutrophilic infiltrate. Means, I will show you the image also. Okay, more and more number of neutrophils will come into that area. Dense neutrophilic infiltrate. Now, 7 to 10 days. Almost 1 week completed, 7 to 10 days. Now what happens here is early granulation tissue is going to form. Early granulation tissue. Means healing, sir. Healing started. Okay. Early granulation tissue. Next, from 10 to 14 days. Sir, there will be maximum granulation tissue, sir. Maximum granulation tissue. Maximum granulation tissue, which means healing. More and more healing is happening. So with 2 months, what happens in 2 months? Microscopy also, scar formation completed. Okay, scar formation, scar. So just tell me, within the first 30 minutes, no visible changes under the light microscopy. 30 minutes to 4 hours, you are going to see the wavy fibers. So now, this is the MCQ. This is the MCQ. What is the first visible change under light microscope? What is the first change that is seen, that is appreciated under the light microscope? It's the wavy fibers. It's the wavy fibers. But gross, it is dark mottling. Okay. First visible sign with your eyes is going to be dark mottling. But with light microscopy, it's going to be the wavy fibers. Okay. Now, early granulation tissue is going to be seen from somewhere around 7 to 10 days. Maximum granulation tissue is going to be seen from 10 to 14 days. Okay, 10 to 14 days maximum granulation tissue. Scar formation is going to be completed by 2 months. Early neutrophilic infiltrate is seen from 1 to 3 days. Okay, sorry, not 1 to 3 days, 12 to 24 hours. Okay, 12 to 24 hours, early neutrophilic infiltrate. And from 1 to 3 days, it is dense neutrophilic infiltrate. Now, what I have to show now, my duty is to show you the images. Images, sir, simple. They go here. Now, what you are appreciated? This is the heart. Okay, this is not a fish piece. Oh, it's not a fish fry piece. Okay, don't think it's a fish fry piece. It's a heart. Are you able to appreciate that little dark area? Little dark area, sir. So, that's the area which have undergone necrosis. Dark mottling. Okay, even here, there is an area of dark mottling. Little dark mottling is there. Okay, here also see dark mottling. Now tell me, dark mottling is going to be seen at what time? 12 to 24 hours, simple. 12 to 24 hours. Okay, 12 to 24 hours. Now, not only that, so the patient is going to have yellow tanning. So, see here, the patient, here also there is myocardial infarction. This area is also dead, but it's looking like more yellowish in color. There is yellow tanning. So, this yellow tanning, it's going to be seen from 1 to 3 days, simple. 1 to 3 days. Done. Now, what are these? Yeah, dekho. These are the cardiac myocytes which are showing the wavy pattern. So, these waves. So, these waves, the wavy fibers are going to be seen from 30 minutes to 4 hours. Okay, 30 minutes to 4 hours, done. Okay, next, what else you are seeing here? See, these are the cardiac myocytes. Okay, these are the cardiac myocytes. But are you able to appreciate these contraction bands? Okay, the heart have undergone contraction because of the reperfusion. The heart have undergone the cardiac myocytes. They are still in contracted phase. This is called as the contraction band necrosis. So the contraction band necrosis is seen when? So the contraction band necrosis, it is seen from 12 to 24 hours. You know it, right? So the contraction band necrosis is seen with 12 to 24 hours. Now, one more thing you should never forget is that in 12 to 24 hours, there is also early neutrophilic infiltrate. Are you able to appreciate some neutrophils are coming? These are the inflammatory cells. The neutrophils are coming into the heart. So, this is, yes, early neutrophilic infiltrates. So, now what you are seeing in this image is early neutrophilic infiltrates as well as contraction band necrosis. Okay, contraction band necrosis. Now, what happens? Sir, in 1 to 3 days, they go in the heart, so many neutrophils are there. All these blue color cells are the inflammatory cells, neutrophils. Okay, so there is inflammation. So this is a dense. There is dense neutrophilic infiltrate. Okay, there is dense neutrophilic infiltrate. Okay, there is dense neutrophilic infiltrate, sir. Seen when? From 1 to 3 days. Okay, now what is this one? What are you able to see? So this is again the heart tissue. Okay, these are all the myocytes. Now, are you able to appreciate these blood vessels? Okay, these blood vessels, the blood vessels are forming. So what you are seeing here, this is the granulation tissue that is being formed. Okay, the granulation tissue is being formed, sir. Okay, granulation tissue, all these are the newer blood vessels. You know, in the granulation tissue, what will be there? The blood vessels, like, you know, fibroblast, collagen fibers are going to be deposited. Okay, so here in this image, what you are seeing is granulation tissue deposition. Granulation tissue deposition. You know, sir, early granulation tissue is going to be seen from 7 to 10 days. 7 to 10 days granulation tissue is going to be deposited, but maximum granulation tissue, if they use the word maximum granulation tissue, the maximum granulation tissue is going to be seen from 10 to 14 days. The 14th day, that's the best answer. And for the 14th day, you are going to have the maximum granulation tissue. Okay, so with this, what we have completed all the changes which are seen, all the, like, you know, okay, let me write one more thing. Earliest findings. So what is the earliest finding that is seen under the gross, gross finding? What earliest finding? Gross earliest finding. With your naked eye, what you can see? It is a dark mottling. You know it. It's a dark mottling, sir. Now under light microscopy. Under light microscopy, it's the waviness of the fibers, cardiac fibers, okay. It's the wavy fibers. Next, under electron microscopy, this we haven't discussed. Sir, in electron microscopy, what you can appreciate, okay, what you can appreciate is, sir, the tissues are undergoing necrosis, right? Necrosis, cell death, okay, cell death. So what is the first visible change that is seen under the electron microscopy? It is a mitochondrial swelling. Okay, it's a mitochondrial swelling, and all the myofibrils are going to be relaxed. Relaxation of the myofibrils with the mitochondrial swelling is the first visible sign under electron microscopy. Relaxation of the myofibrils with swelling of the mitochondria in the myocytes is the electron microscopic finding. Okay, three answers completed, sir. So with this, we have seen what exactly is happening in the myocardial infarction. Now, what are the complications? Take a look here, sir. Now, this part of the myocardium, for example, this part of the myocardium is dead, infarcted. Okay, that part of the myocardium is infarcted. So what are the complications that are seen? Okay, what are the complications that are going to occur? Okay, what are the complications? What do you think? Let me write here, complications. Now, use your logic. Now, that part of the myocardium is dead, no doubt. So, the wall is going to be stronger or the wall is going to be weaker? Now, the wall is going to be weaker. Now, it's just a scar tissue. Collagen fibers, it's not a muscle now. It's going to be replaced with a scar tissue. So, that part of the myocardium is weak, so it can dilate, okay, because of the enormous amount of the pressures in the left ventricle, it will undergo dilatation, okay. So there will be ventricular complication numbers. Complication number one, ventricular aneurysms. Okay, there will be ventricular aneurysm. Yes, one more, you are true. Okay, aneurysm, rupture, there can be rupture. Okay, here there is rupture, dekho. There is a rupture. Here you can clearly see the aneurysm. The left ventricle wall is dilated. There is aneurysm. Okay, which is called as the mural thrombosis and mural aneurysms can occur. So here also, left ventricular aneurysm, it's dilated. Left ventricle is dilated. The ventricular aneurysms, ventricular rupture, or there is a possibility of arrhythmias. There is a possibility that the heart will go into arrhythmias after myocardial infarction. The fourth complication is going to be Dressler syndrome. So now, students, this is very important. What exactly is the Dressler syndrome, sir? Dressler syndrome means, imagine I'm the person who have developed the myocardial infarction. Okay, I'm the one who have developed the myocardial infarction. Luckily, okay, I got admitted in the hospital and you saved me. Okay, you saved me. Done. Okay, thank you. But after 2-3 weeks, after 2-3 weeks, I'm going to, okay, I'm survived, okay. But I'm going to develop fibrinous pericarditis. Fibrinous pericarditis, see, whenever the myocardial infarction occurred, the heart antigens, the antigens which are present inside the heart, now they are actually exposed to the immune system. The immune system will try to attack the heart. Okay, it's a, like autoimmune disease. It's autoimmune pericarditis. This Dressler syndrome is autoimmune pericarditis. Autoimmune pericarditis. Okay. So, seen after 1 to 3 weeks, what exactly is this Dressler syndrome? Autoimmune pericarditis. Okay. Of which type? It is fibrinous type. Okay. It's going to cause fibrinous pericarditis. It's going to cause a fibrinous pericarditis. Autoimmune pericarditis is going to cause a fibrinous type of pericarditis. Okay, that is the Dressler syndrome. Autoimmune pericarditis seen after 1 to 3 weeks after myocardial infarction. Now, after this, what else you should know? Okay, for your exams, what else you should know is, sir, myocardial infarction, where it can occur? It can occur on the right side, possible. It can occur on the left side. So, both it can occur on the left side as well as on the right side. For example, if it is occurring on the left side, my left ventricle is, for example, have undergone myocardial infarction. If my left ventricle have undergone myocardial infarction, now that left ventricle become weak or it becomes strong. It becomes weak. Now it is not able to pump properly. When it is not able to pump properly, stroke volume decreases. See, the inotropic effect decreases. The stroke volume decreases. The cardiac output decreases. So now heart is failing as a pump. Heart is not able to contract properly because of myocardial infarction. So gradually with time, there can be a possibility of left-sided heart failure. The left ventricle is not a good pump now. It is not able to pump. It's not able to pump properly. So when it is not able to pump properly, what happens, sir? The blood is not going into the aorta. The blood is not going forward. The blood will start to accumulate back. The back pressures are going to be generated. The left ventricle cannot contract properly. So left ventricular end-diastolic volume increases. Left ventricular end-diastolic pressures increases. So there will be back pulling of the back. The back pressures are going to be generated. So now the blood will start to accumulate. There will be pulmonary congestion. Blood will start to accumulate in the lung. There will be pulmonary congestion. Later, the pulmonary congestion will be followed by pulmonary edema, sir. Pulmonary edema. Okay. So now let me write the important points, sir. Okay. Let me write it here. So left-sided heart failure. First, left-sided heart failure. So if there is a left-sided heart failure, which means simple, heart failure means heart is failing. Heart is not a good pump now. Might be because of myocardial infarction. Myocardial infarction. So what are the clinical features going to be? What are the clinical features, sir, for the patient? The clinical features are going to be, sir, when the left ventricle is failing, blood will start to accumulate. See, from where left ventricle is getting the blood? From left atria. From where left atria is receiving the blood? From the lungs. When the left side of the heart, when it is failing, there will be pulmonary congestion, sir. Okay, back pressures are generated. So there is going to be pulmonary congestion. Now, this pulmonary congestion with time can develop into pulmonary edema. Congestion is just like, you know, the stagnation of the blood. Pulmonary edema means the blood is getting into the alveolus. Okay, getting into the lungs. So pulmonary congestion and pulmonary edema are going to be there. So, because of this pulmonary congestion, pulmonary edema, what are the clinical features? What the patient is going to suffer with? So, the patient is going to suffer with dyspnea. That's the problem. If I'm having heart failure, if my left ventricle is failing to pump, if it's not a good pump, the first symptom is not going to be here, sir. The first symptom is going to be with the respiration. Okay. Now, blood is pulling into the lungs. So, I'll be having respiratory distress. So, there'll be dyspnea. Okay, there will be dyspnea, sir. The patient is going to have dyspnea. This dyspnea is going to be worsen, especially in the lying down position. When the patient is lying down, more venous return to the heart, more blood is going to the heart. Okay, when the patient is going from standing position to lying down position, gravity is not there now. Normally, when the patient is like this, gravity will pull the down, pull the blood down. So there will be peripheral pooling of the blood. But when the patient is going down to the lying position, more blood will go to the heart, more load on the heart, more preload, more end-diastolic volume. When more blood is going to the heart, already that's a weak heart. Already that's a failing heart. It's a weak pump. Now when you put more blood, more symptoms are more pulmonary congestion, more pulmonary edema, more symptoms. So when the patient is going to lying down position, when he will go to the lying down position? During night, sir. So during night, there'll be dyspnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, sir. Okay, suddenly he will wake up, he cannot breathe, breathlessness is going to occur in left-sided heart failures. Okay, so dyspnea is going to be seen. Now, blood is leaking into the alveolus. Blood is leaking into the alveolus. Their RBC are going to be totally degraded. So, iron is going to be present. Okay, now this RBC, iron is going to be present inside the alveolus. Now, this iron will be eaten by the macrophages. Okay, this iron will be totally consumed by the macrophages. So, these macrophages are called as iron-laden macrophages. Iron-laden macrophages. Okay, so these macrophages are called as heart failure cells. So, heart failure cells are present where? Sir, heart failure cells are going to be present in lungs. Heart failure cells are present in the lungs. What exactly are the heart failure cells? Sir, heart failure cells are nothing but the macrophages which have eaten up the iron. From where this iron came? Because of the RBC destruction. Why the RBCs are getting destroyed in the lungs? Why? Because of the pulmonary edema. Pulmonary edema, RBCs are going to leak into the alveolus. There the RBCs are going to be consumed by the macrophages. So the iron will start to accumulate inside the macrophages. Simple. Okay. So look here. There is chronic venous congestion. There is venous congestion inside the lungs. Okay, there is congested capillaries in the alveolar septa. Now, even you can clearly see, what are these cells, sir? These are, see, alveoli, they are containing hemosiderin. Hemosiderin is nothing but the iron pigment, right? Iron pigment. Hemosiderin is iron pigment. So, hemosiderin-laden macrophages, which are called as heart failure cells. Image-based question. See, dekho, these are the iron-laden macrophages. Okay, iron-laden macrophages. Image-based question for your FMG exam and the NEET PG exams. Yeah. Okay. In your exam, they will ask you, sir, these are iron-laden macrophages, okay? What is the stain for iron? Stain? What is the stain that is used to look the iron, to look for the iron? Any idea? Fun mode, any idea? Varun Kashyap? Any idea? It is Prussian blue. Okay? Prussian blue, sir. Okay, Prussian blue, also called as, yes, fun mode, you are true. Pearl stain. Okay, Prussian blue or pearl stain. Okay, so Prussian blue or pearl stain is used for the iron. Okay, so done. Next, what else I want you to know is, sir, there is a possibility of the right-sided heart failure also. If the right-sided heart, okay, the right-sided heart, if it is a weak pump, is not contracting properly. Now you can ask me, sir, what is the most common cause of right-sided heart failure? What is the most common cause of right-sided heart failure? Myocardial infarction can cause left-sided heart failure. Okay. What is the most common cause of right-sided heart failure? Why the right ventricle is failing? Right ventricle is not contracting now. So, the blood is not going into the lungs. Okay. Now, let me put it in a simple way. So, this is your heart. Okay. So, this is the right side of the heart, right atria, right ventricle, left atria, left ventricle. Now, this right ventricle is weak. Now, it's not contracting properly. There is a right-sided heart failure. Now, why there is a right-sided heart failure? The answer, the most common cause is going to be left-sided heart failure. If there is a left-sided heart failure, today or tomorrow, there will be right-sided heart failure, sir. Okay, back pressures are going to generate it. The back pressures will ultimately come to the right-sided heart. Okay, so when right-sided heart is damaged or when it is failing as a pump, now what happens? They go, you need to understand this. So, this right-sided heart, what it is doing, sir, it is receiving the blood from superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. Via the superior vena cava and via the inferior vena cava, the right atrium or the right-sided heart is receiving the deoxygenated blood or the venous blood. Okay, deoxygenated blood or the venous blood. Now, when this right ventricle, it is not contracting properly. The blood is not going forward. The blood is not going into the lungs. So, the back pressures are going to be generated. The blood is not in the forward circulation. Back pressures are generated. So, the pressures in the superior vena cava elevated. So, when the pressures in the superior vena cava elevates, automatically the pressure in the internal jugular veins, the pressure in the internal jugular veins are also going to be elevated. So, there is clinical features. Now, if there is a right-sided heart failure, okay, if there is a right-sided heart failure, there is distended jugular venous pressures. The jugular venous pressures are going to be, the jugular venous, elevated, the jugular venous pressures are going to be elevated, and the jugular vein is going to be distended. Okay, the jugular vein, distended jugular vein, okay. And the jugular venous pressure, the pressure in the jugular vein also is more, sir, venous congestion, more, okay, pressure. Now, inferior vena cava also. See, dekho, the pressures are going to be piled up. Normally, from the liver, the inferior vena cava will bring the blood, to the right atrium. Okay? But now, whenever there is right-sided heart failure, now there is venous congestion. Venous congestion in the liver. Venous congestion in the spleen. So, right. The patient is going to have venous congestion. Where? Venous congestion in the liver, sir. The blood is getting accumulated in the liver. And there is venous congestion in the spleen. Okay. So, whenever there is venous congestion in the liver, this is how the liver looks like. So, this is the nutmeg liver, sir. Okay. All you can see here, all these are the blood. Okay. So, the blood vessels which are getting congested. So, there is venous congestion in the liver that will give you which appearance? Nutmeg appearance. Okay. Nutmeg is a seed. Nutmeg is a seed. So, the liver is going to look like a nutmeg. Okay. Nutmeg liver. Nutmeg liver because of the venous congestion inside the liver. Now, the spleen is also going to be congested. Spleen is also going to be congested with a lot of blood. Now, again, there also in the liver also blood is going to be leaked. And even the spleen also, the blood is going to be leaked into the parenchyma. Now, RBCs are going to be leaked into the parenchyma. And the RBCs are going to be eaten up by the macrophages. Again, the hemosiderin pigment is going to be deposited. So, in the spleen, the question that they will ask you is something called as a gamma-antibodies. Okay, gamma-antibodies. Sir, what are these gamma-antibodies? So, these gamma-antibodies, they are nothing but, deposits of iron pigments. The deposits of iron in the spleen because of the congestion, iron deposition, calcium. Okay, iron and calcium, sir, important. Iron, calcium along with some granulomatous tissue. Okay, along with the granulomas. Granuloma and inflammatory cells. So, these are the gamma-antibodies. Sir, these gamma-antibodies are seen in the spleen. Seen in which condition? In venous congestion associated with right-sided heart failure. Whenever there is a right-sided heart failure, there is going to be venous congestion in the liver as well as the spleen. Why? Because from the spleen, from the liver, the blood will have to go via the inferior vena cava to the right atrium. Right side of the heart. When the right side of the heart is failed, now more blood will start to congestion. Okay, like more blood will start to accumulate inside the liver and spleen, leading to the formation of nutmeg liver and gamma-antibodies. Okay, gamma-antibodies. So these are the important points which I want you to know regarding the right-sided heart failure as well as the left-sided heart failure. Most common cause of right-sided heart failure is left-sided heart failure. Okay, so with this, the heart failure topic is completed. So, with this, the heart failure topic is completed. We have seen types of angina, stable angina, unstable angina, okay, variant angina. Also, we have seen about the ST segmented elevated MI as well as non-ST segmented elevated MI. Also, we have discussed the topic of heart failure. Okay. Now, after this, there is a small miscellaneous topic. It's a small miscellaneous topic, but which is very much important for your exam. So, that topic is pericarditis. Okay, pericarditis. So, we'll discuss some important points about the pericarditis. Okay, some important points about the pericarditis we'll discuss. And let's close this topic for today. So, all this we have discussed in the yesterday's class. Now, let's discuss about the pericarditis. Now, dekho guys here. I have already written this for you. Now, you know, The heart is made up of how many layers? So the heart is made up of three layers. The red color layer, which I have pointed here, the red color layer, the innermost layer of the heart, the red color layer. Okay, let me put the mark. So this layer, the red color layer, that is the endocardium. Okay. Now this layer, which I am pointing, this layer is the myocardium. Myocardium. Okay. Now, the outermost layer, The outermost layer is called as a pericardium, sir. But the point which I want you to know, is, sir, dekho, this pericardium is further divided into visceral pericardium. So this layer is the visceral pericardium, and this layer, the outermost layer of the pericardium, is called as, the parietal pericardium, visceral pericardium and parietal pericardium. So visceral and parietal pericardium. Okay, visceral pericardium and parietal pericardium. Okay, so I should actually tell you in a different way for your better understanding. Okay, let me put it this way. Inner endocardium, myocardium and pericardium. Okay, now this pericardium is actually divided into two. Okay, serous pericardium means innermost, and fibrous pericardium is outermost. Okay, so this outermost layer, which I have shown in the golden color, it's called as a fibrous pericardium. Okay, outermost layer, sir. Now the serous pericardium, it is further divided into parietal pericardium and visceral pericardium. Okay, parietal pericardium and visceral pericardium. Okay, now remember this space between parietal pericardium and visceral pericardium, this space is called as pericardial cavity, MCQ. So pericardial cavity is a space between, it's a space between parietal pericardium and visceral pericardium, sir. So there is going to be pericardial fluid. Okay, pericardial fluid is going to be present in that area. Okay, so in pericardial effusion, you know what exactly is pericardial effusion? Pericardial effusion means the fluid accumulation. Okay, the fluid accumulation, sir. Fluid or the blood accumulation. So this pericardial effusion occurs where? In this pericardial cavity. Okay, if the pericardial effusion occurs, if the fluid is occurring, then it is called as pericardial effusion. Okay, or we will also discuss about the cardiac tamponade in a minute. We will also discuss about the what is pericardial tamponade. Okay, we'll discuss, sir. What is pericardial tamponade or pericardial effusion? Simple, fluid accumulation in this cavity, in this pericardial cavity. What is this pericardial cavity? Sir, pericardial cavity is a space between parietal pericardium as well as the visceral pericardium. The parietal pericardium and the visceral pericardium together, they are called as serous pericardium. Okay, now in pericarditis, what you should know is, sir, pericardium, you know the structure. What is the inflammation of pericardium called as? Pericarditis. Inflammation of the pericardium is called as pericarditis. Why pericarditis? Why? One thing you know. So Dressler syndrome, post MI pericarditis, after getting the myocardial infarction, within 1 to 3 weeks, the patient will develop the pericarditis. Fibrinous pericarditis, sir. That is called as Dressler syndrome. Okay. See, the most common cause of this pericarditis is unclear. Okay, the most common cause is unclear. Okay. There are viral pericarditis. The Coxsackie virus can cause pericarditis. Bacteria like TB. Okay, TB can cause TB pericarditis. Okay, TB pericarditis. And renal failure, if the kidneys are failing, okay, that will cause uremia, urea and creatinine accumulation in the body. Uremia is going to be there. Toxic substances will start to accumulate in the body. Now, these substances will also go and deposit within the pericardium and will cause inflammation. So viral pericarditis, bacterial pericarditis, uremic pericarditis, or post MI pericarditis. Even pericarditis is seen in rheumatic. Okay, even it's seen in rheumatic heart disease also. In rheumatic heart disease also, there is bread and butter pericarditis, fibrinous pericarditis we have seen. Okay, there are many etiologies. No one will ask you about the etiology. This Dressler syndrome is important. Okay, Dressler syndrome is important. Now, sir, if there is pericarditis, the patient is having pericarditis, what are the clinical features? The patient is going to have a severe chest pain, sir, sharp chest pain, not like angina. Anginal chest pain is going to be dull and diffuse. The pain is going to radiate towards the jaw. The pain is going to radiate towards the arm. Okay, that is the anginal pain. But if the patient is having pericarditis, there is going to be sharp chest pain. So this pain is going to be changing. This pain is going to be changing with the position. This pain is going to be changing with breath. Okay, whenever I am taking a deep breath, okay, whenever the person is having pericarditis, whenever he is taking the deep breath, the pain intensity will increase. Pain intensity will increase. And when the person is now in supine position, when the patient is going into the supine position, lying down position, more blood flow to the heart, more stretching of the pericardium, more pain. See, anginal pain, remember, anginal pain, it will not change with the position, it will not change with the breathing pattern. There is no change in the pain with the breathing pattern, and there is no change in the pain with positioning. But in this pericarditis, sharp pain, change in the intensity of the pain with the positioning, change in the intensity of the pain with breathing. More breathing, deep breathing, severe pain, sharp pain. Supine position, sharp pain. Okay, pain gets better. Okay, when the patient is sitting or leaning like this, the pain is going to be like decreased. Okay, the intensity of the pain decreases. When you do physical examination, that is auscultation, when you do the auscultation, now you will hear the pericardial friction rub, auscultatory finding. Okay, even in yesterday's class we have discussed pericardial friction rub is seen in rheumatic, in a child with rheumatic heart disease, involvement of pericardium. Bread and butter pericarditis, pericardial friction rub. Pericardium is inflamed. So, pericardial friction rub is going to be seen with every heartbeat. Okay. Now, what are the ECG findings? From the beginning, I am telling you, not only in myocardial infarction, even in pericarditis also, there is going to be ST segment elevation. Okay, there will be ST segment elevation, sir. But what kind of ST segment elevation? It's a little different. It is concave ST segment elevation. Okay, let me show you. So, this is the ECG of a patient who is suffering with. Okay, this is the ECG of a patient who is suffering with pericarditis. Now, they go here. What are all these? So, these are ST segment elevations. Okay, these are all ST segment elevations. Let me put the baseline. So, this is the baseline, right? This is the baseline. Okay, this is the baseline, but the ST segment is elevated. ST segment is elevated like this. Okay, here also see. ST segments are elevated. Okay, here also this is the baseline, ST segment is elevated, here more concavity is there, here also ST segment elevation. So, in acute pericarditis, when the patient is having acute pericarditis, what will be there, what is the ECG finding? Sir, widespread concave, this is important, the concave, okay, concave, not convex, concave, okay, concave ST segment elevations are seen, one thing, not only this, this is the first finding. There is going to be PR segment depression. Okay, PR segment depression. I will show you the PR segment depressions. Okay, so PR segment depression is present throughout the pericardial leads. Okay, now look here. So, this is the normal P wave. Okay, normal P wave. This is the PR segment, right? Now, PR segment, see, dekho, it's little depressed. In compared to the baseline, it is little depressed. Here also, see, there is ST elevation, that is concave. Here also, PR segment depression. The PR segment is depressed with the ST segment. With the ST segment elevation, concave ST segment elevation. Okay. Now, here also, dekho, the patient is having PR segment depression. There is a PR segment depression with a concave ST segment elevation. Okay. So, PR segment depression with concave ST segment elevation. PR segment depression with concave ST segment elevation. Okay. Same thing. Here also see. PR segment depression. ST segment elevation, that's concave. Okay. Same thing, sir. So, whenever you see such a ECG, with the PR depression and a concave ST segment elevations in your life, never forget about pericarditis. Never forget about the pericarditis. Okay. So, there are different types of pericarditis. There are different types which is not that much important for your exam. Now, especially when the pericarditis, it heals. Okay. When pericarditis, it heals. Healing, sir. The pericarditis is healed. Okay. Now, you can appreciate this white color healing. Okay. Actually, here fibrosis occurred. So, healing occurred. Now, this is called as soldier's plaque. Okay, so pericarditis that is healed, now it is called as soldier's plaque or milk spot. It is seen in pericarditis which is a healed pericarditis. Okay, and so for your exam there are different types of pericarditis, like fibrinous pericarditis, serous, hemorrhagic, caseous, different types of pericarditis are there. For your exam, what you need to know is this, will they will ask you this, caseous pericarditis. Caseous means you already know, it's a cheesy caseous necrosis seen in histoplasma. Okay, TB we have seen. So caseous pericarditis, it is seen in TB infection. Okay, like a cheese like pericardium. Okay, so caseous pericarditis it is seen in TB. Okay, in TB, other types of pericarditis is also seen, but caseous pericarditis, someone asks you, caseous pericarditis, it is seen in TB, sir. Okay, TB. Yeah. So, with this, the pericarditis topic is also completed. Now, what we are left with? Okay, what we are left with? We are left with one more condition, okay, regarding same pericardial disease, which is called as cardiac tamponade, pericardial tamponade, cardiac tamponade. So, what exactly is cardiac tamponade, sir? Any idea, guys? Any idea do you have what is cardiac tamponade? Cardiac tamponade. Accumulation of fluid inside the pericardium. Accumulation of blood inside the pericardium. See, that is called as a pericardial effusion, right? That is called as a pericardial effusion. Now, what exactly is pericardial tamponade? See, dekho. Sir, let me write here. Let me write and explain. Pericardial tamponade. What exactly is pericardial tamponade? See, pericardial tamponade means accumulation. Yes, true. There is accumulation of fluid around the heart. Accumulation of fluid around the heart, sir. But this fluid is so much, it is actually compressing the heart. It's actually compressing the heart. Okay. See, now here they go. Sir, heart, now we have just stirred the pericardium. We have just opened the pericardium. Now see, blood is there. Now this blood from outside is actually compressing the heart chambers. Okay, now this is called as cardiac tamponade. In effusion, there is only fluid. Fluid is there, but that fluid is not actually compressing the heart. Now there is blood or fluid, so much amount of blood, it's actually trying to compress the heart chambers, showing the pressure from outside, sir. Okay, so that's what is cardiac tamponade. Okay, or pericardial tamponade. What exactly it is? Accumulation. Okay, accumulation of fluid. Okay, accumulation of fluid. This fluid can be blood. Okay, accumulation of fluid or blood, you can say, in pericardial cavity. Pericardial cavity. But what this fluid is doing? Okay, accumulation in the pericardial cavity leading to compression. Leading to the compression of heart chambers. The heart chambers are being compressed, sir. Even in this echo, you can clearly see, sir, these are the ventricles, right? These are the ventricles. Now, outside the heart, even this echo, there is fluid accumulation. The black color thing is a fluid, right? Okay, black color appearance is a fluid. Now, there is fluid accumulation around the heart. This fluid is starting to compress the heart. Okay, so here also, dekho. Sir, this is the pericardial cavity. In the pericardial cavity, there is fluid. There is fluid, sir. So, this fluid is starting to compress the heart from all the sides. See, there is fluid. Okay, fluid in the pericardium. Okay, pericardial cavity. Now, if the patient is having this cardiac tamponade. Okay, sir, cardiac tamponade. The patient is going to have something. I have downloaded this from the internet. Very beautiful thing. The patient is going to have the Bextrat. So, what exactly is this Bextrat? Okay, the patient who is suffering with the cardiac tamponade, he is going to have the Bextrat. So, what exactly is this Bextrat? So, the patient is going to have muffled heart sounds. The heart sounds are not going to be visible properly. Why? Because fluid, blood accumulation. Around the heart, there is going to be the blood, sir. Now, some students will get it out. Okay, let me put this way. Sir, why there is blood around the heart? Blood around the heart, sir. Okay, try to understand like this. Sir, this is the heart. Okay, this is the heart. Now, heart is surrounded by what? Heart is surrounded by pericardium. Okay, let me put it with the other color. So, this is the pericardium which is surrounding the heart. Pericardium, sir. Okay. Now, imagine this patient is having myocardial infarction. Okay, now this patient is having myocardial infarction, sir. Normally, within the ventricle, who is going to be there? Blood is going to be there. This is the blood, sir. The blood. Now, this patient is having myocardial infarction. This part of the heart is dead. Now, that is going to be the weak area, sir. Okay. Now, what happens? I have explained you as a complication, this part of the heart might undergo rupture. Whenever there is a rupture, what happens? Now the blood is starting to come out. Now this blood is accumulating. Now this blood is accumulating in the pericardial cavity. Okay, now this blood will start to compress the heart chambers from all the sides. Okay, now do you think heart will fill properly? No, heart is not totally compressed. The heart chambers are compressed. So it's not receiving the blood. It's not able to contract properly. The preload decreases. The heart is being compressed, sir. Okay, that's a problem. Okay, that's a problem. Okay. So as the heart is surrounded, by the blood, whenever you try to auscultate, the heart sounds are going to be muffled. Muffled heart sounds are seen. Okay. Now the heart is totally compressed, sir. The heart is totally compressed, from all sides. So do you think it's properly receiving the blood? It is properly receiving the blood now? No, heart is compressed. The pressures inside the heart is more. So it is not properly receiving the blood from the internal jugular veins. So what happened to the internal jugular veins? There'll be distension. Distension of the jugular veins are going to be seen. Okay, see, they go distended jugular veins. Okay, distended jugular veins are going to be seen. Okay, next thing. So the heart is being compressed. It is not filling properly, So whenever it contracts, there will be less cardiac output, less preload, So less will be the, stroke volume. Okay, you have decreased the preload. The heart is being totally compressed. It's not filling properly. So less preload. So when you decrease the preload, automatically stroke volume decreases. The Frank Starling's law. Okay, so low blood pressure. The blood pressure is going to be low in these patients. So this is the big stress. So patient who is, the patient who is having this cardiac tamponade. See, blood is accumulating around the heart, compressing the heart. The patient is going to have muffled heart sounds, distended jugular venous pressures. With low BP, the patient is at risk of death, sir. The patient will die. Okay, if you don't intervene, the patient is going to die, sir. Okay, that's the point which I want you to know. So this is cardiac tamponade. Now in this cardiac tamponade, bextradicin. Okay, apart from bextrad, what are the ECG findings that are seen? Sir, can you anyone tell me what are the ECG findings? Can anyone tell me in this class what are the ECG findings? Any student? One mode, can you tell me what are the ECG findings? See, then here, look. Now the heart actually, it is surrounded by the blood. Okay, the heart is actually surrounded by the blood. Now, when the heart is surrounded by such fluids, do you think the proper electrical conduction is going to happen to the skin? Properly, this electrical activity is going to be properly connected to the skin? No. So, look here, the ECG is going to be low voltage ECG. This is a low voltage. See, all these waves are small waves. Okay, it's a low voltage ECG. One thing. And I used to remember something like this. Sir, the heart is totally now in a fluid-filled cavity. Now, such a heart is going to dance. It's going to move. So, with the heart beat, one time it is coming nearer to the, the chest wall. It's going back. It's moving, sir. It's totally in a fluid-filled cavity. So, now what happens is because of this, now there will be electrical, small waves, large wave. Small, large. So the subsequent heartbeats, one time high voltage is coming, low voltage, high voltage, low voltage, something like this. So this is called as electrical. See here also, small, large. Okay, so this is called as electrical alternates. Okay. So, electrical alternates, they will directly ask you. Sir, low voltage electrical alternates, low voltage EKG or ECG with electrical alternates is seen in cardiac tamponade, sir. Apart from this, what else you should know is, sir, these patients are going to have something called as pulses, paradoxes. Okay, so pulses, paradoxes. So, what exactly is this pulses, paradoxes? Normally, guys, remember, during inspiration, during inspiration, what happens is, so the BP will fall, sir. Normally, this is something normal, our BP will fall. During inspiration, whenever you do the inspiration, BP falls. But this fall is not going to be more than 10 mmHg. Okay, the fall is going to be there, but less than 10 mmHg. Now imagine my BP is 120, systolic BP is 120. Okay, but whenever I do inspiration, my BP actually falls, sir, but not more than 10 mmHg. Okay, if it is 120, 115, it will go to 115. Yes, it falls, but not more than 10 mmHg. Okay, if there is more than 10 mmHg fall, more than 10 mmHg fall is called as pulsus paradoxus. This pulsus paradoxus is a feature of, this pulsus paradoxus, it's a feature of what? It's a feature, okay, it's a feature of, okay, it's a feature of cardiac tamponade. It's a feature of cardiac tamponade. Okay, if you ask me why, sir, if you ask me why, let me tell you, whenever you do the inspiration, okay, whenever you do the inspiration, sir, during inspiration, that in the thorax, negative pressures are generated, sir. Okay, your chest wall is expanding, so there will be negative intrathoracic pressure. So whenever there is negative intrathoracic pressure, the more venous blood will come to this area, sir. Okay, this negative intrathoracic pressure will suck the blood, will suck the venous blood. Okay, so more venous return. Okay, inspiration, during inspiration, negative intrathoracic pressure, then it's negative pressure or the vacuum, I should say, it sucks the blood. More venous return is going to be there. And more venous return is there. So what happened to the right ventricular size? So right ventricular size increases. Okay, right ventricular size increases. Okay. Now, right ventricular size is increasing. Right ventricle, see, from to outside and inside, right ventricle, now it will bulge. It will bulge, sir. It will bulge. Okay, it will expand. Now, here in this condition, what is this? Cardiac tamponade, cardiac tamponade. See, now what I am doing? I am doing inspiration. Whenever I do the inspiration, more venous return will be there. Now, right ventricle will enlarge. But where it will enlarge, sir? Right ventricle, it cannot enlarge outward. It cannot bulge us outward. It cannot expand outward because outside there is a blood. Blood clot is there. It is compressing from outside. So now what happens is the interventricular septum bulges into the left ventricle. The interventricular septum, it bulges into the left ventricle. So right ventricular size increases. The interventricular septum, okay, the interventricular septum bulges into left ventricle. So what happened to the LV size, left ventricular cavity size? Left ventricular cavity size decreases. Now the left ventricle, see, the interventricular septum is bulging with inspiration. Whenever the person is taking the inspiration, the left ventricular cavity size decreases, sir. The left ventricular cavity size decreases because of the bulging of the interventricular septum. So when the left ventricular cavity size decreases, what happens? The filling decreases, okay? Stroke volume decreases, PP decreases, okay? So when the left ventricular size decreases, stroke volume decreases, automatically BP decreases more than 10 mmHg, more than 10 mmHg fall will be seen. So this is called as pulsus paradoxus. Okay, pulsus paradoxus, sir. Okay, so these are some important points which I want you to know. The patient is going to have pulsus paradoxus, low voltage EKG. Okay, pulsus paradoxus, low voltage EKG, electrical alternance, PECS triad, which includes the muffled heart sounds with the distended jugular veins and low BP. Okay, the patient is going to suffer with the low BP. And what exactly is the cardiac tamponade? I have explained to you. Cardiac tamponade is the compression of the heart. The heart is being compressed from all the sides because of the fluid accumulation in the pericardial cavity. So with this, even pericardial diseases also completed. Hope the class is helpful, sir, for today. Now let's take a break for today and let's meet tomorrow with the new topics. Thank you. Goodbye.